Track 3.
It's called California Classic Cuisine, Anne tells me, leaning in close after we ordered. The statement deserves a reaction, I suppose. And since Scott and Courtney are discussing the merits of the Post's gossip column, it's up to me to reply. You mean, compared to, say, California cuisine? I ask carefully, measuring each word, then lamely add, or post-California cuisine. I mean, I know it sounds so trendy, but there is a world of difference. It's subtle, she says, but it's there. I've heard of post-California cuisine, I say, acutely aware of the design of the restaurant, the exposed pipe and the columns, and the open pizza kitchen and the deck chairs. In fact, I've even eaten it. No baby vegetables, scallops and burritos, wasabi crackers? Am I on the right track? And by the way, did anyone ever tell you that you look exactly like Garfield, but run over and skinned, and then someone threw an ugly Ferragamo sweater over you before they rushed you to the vet? Fusilli? Olive oil on brie? Exactly, Anne says, impressed. Oh, Courtney, where did you find Patrick? He's so knowledgeable about things. I mean, Lewis's idea of California cuisine is half an orange and some gelati, she gushes, then laughs, encouraging me to laugh with her, which I do hesitantly. For an appetizer, I ordered radicchio with some kind of free-range squid. Anne and Scott both had the monkfish ragu with violets. Courtney almost fell asleep when she had to exert the energy to read the menu, but before she slid off her chair, I grabbed both shoulders, propping her up, and Anne ordered for her, something simple and light like Cajun popcorn, perhaps, which wasn't on the menu, but since Anne knows no, the chef, he made up a special little batch just for Courtney. Scott and Anne insisted that we all order some kind of black and medium rare redfish, a deck chair specialty, which was, luckily for them, an entree on one of the mock menus that Jean made up for me. If it hadn't, and if they nevertheless insisted on my ordering it, the odds were pretty good that after dinner tonight, I would have broken into Scott and Anne's studio at around 2 this morning, after late night with David Letterman, and with an axe, chopped them to pieces, first making Anne watch Scott bleed to death from gaping chest wounds, and then I would have found a way to get to Exeter, where I would pour a bottle of acid all over their son's slanty-eyed zipperhead face. Our waitress is a little hardbody, who is wearing gold faux pearl tasseled lizard slingback pumps. I forgot to return my videotapes to the store tonight, and I curse myself silently while Scott orders 2 large bottles of San Pellegrino. It's called California Classic Cuisine, Scott is telling me. Why don't we all go to Zeus Bar next week? Anne suggests to Scott. You think we'd have a problem getting a table on Friday? Scott is wearing a red and purple and black striped cashmere intarsia sweater from Paul Stewart, baggy Ralph Lauren corduroys, and Cole Haan leather moccasins. Well, maybe, he says. That's a good idea. I like it a lot, Anne says, picking up a small violet off her plate and sniffing the flower before placing it carefully on her tongue. She's wearing a red, purple, and black hand-knitted mohair and wool sweater from Koos Vanderacker Couture and slacks from Anne Klein with suede open-toe pumps. A waiter, though not the hard body, strides over to take another drink order. J&B, straight, I say, before anyone else orders. Courtney orders a champagne on the rocks, which secretly appalls me. Oh, she says, as if reminded by something. Can I have that with a twist? A twist of what? I ask irritably, unable to stop myself. Let me guess, melon? And I'm thinking, oh my God, why didn't you return those goddamn videos, Bateman, you dumb son of a bitch? You mean lemon, miss, the waiter says, giving me an icy stare. Yes, of course, lemon. Courtney nods, seeming lost in some kind of dream, but enjoying it, oblivious to it. I'll have a glass of the... Oh, gosh. I guess the acacia, Scott says, and then addresses the table. Do I want a white? Do I really want a Chardonnay? We can eat the redfish with a Cabernet. Go for it, Anne says cheerily. Okay, I'll have the... Oh, geez. The Sauvignon Blanc, Scott says. The waiter smiles, confused. Scotty, Anne shrieks. The Sauvignon Blanc? Just teasing, he snickers. I'll have the Chardonnay, the acacia. You complete jerk, Anne smiles, relieved. You're funny. I'm having the Chardonnay, Scott tells the waiter. That's nice, Courtney says, patting Scott's hand. I'll just have... Anne stalls, deliberating. Oh, I'll just have a Diet Coke. Scott looks up from a piece of cornbread he was dipping into a small tin of olive oil. You're not drinking tonight? No, Anne says, smiling naughtily. Who knows why? And who fucking cares? I'm not in the mood. Not even for a glass of the Chardonnay? Scott asks. How about a Sauvignon Blanc? I have this aerobics class at 9, she says, slipping, losing control. I really shouldn't. Well, then, I don't want anything, Scott says, disappointed. I mean, I have one at 8, an exclusive. Does anyone want to guess where I won't be tomorrow morning at 8? I ask. No, honey, I know how much you like the acacia. Anne reaches out and squeezes Scott's hand. No, babe, I'll stick to the Pellegrino, Scott says, pointing. I'm tapping my fingers very loudly on the tabletop, whispering, shit, 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 to myself. Courtney's eyes are half closed, and she's breathing deeply. Listen, I'll be daring, Anne finally says. I'll have a Diet Coke with rum. Scott sighs, then smiles, beaming, really. Good. That's a caffeine-free Diet Coke, right? Anne asks the waiter. You know, I interrupt, you should have it with Diet Pepsi. It's much better. Really? Anne asks. What do you mean? You should have the Diet Pepsi instead of the Diet Coke, I say. It's much better. It's fizzier. It has a cleaner taste. It mixes better with rum and has a lower sodium content. The waiter, Scott, Anne, and even Courtney, they all stare at me as if I've offered some kind of diabolical, apocalyptic observation. As if I were shattering a myth highly held, or destroying an oath that was solemnly regarded, and it suddenly seems almost hushed in deck chairs. Last night, I rented a movie called Inside Lydia's Ass, and while on two halcyon and in fact sipping a Diet Pepsi, I watched as Lydia, a totally tan, bleach blonde hard body with a perfect ass and great full tits, while on all fours, gave head to this guy with a huge cock, while another gorgeous blonde, little hard body, with a perfectly trimmed blonde pussy, knelt behind Lydia, and after eating her ass out and sucking on her cunt, started to push a long, greased silver vibrator into Lydia's ass, and fucked her with it, while she continued to eat her pussy, and the guy with the huge cock came all over Lydia's face as she sucked his balls, and then Lydia bucked to an authentic-looking, fairly strong orgasm. And then the girl behind Lydia crawled around and licked the cum from Lydia's face, and then made Lydia suck on the vibrator. The new Stephen Bishop came out last Tuesday, and at Tower Records yesterday I bought the compact disc, the cassette, and the album because I wanted to own all three formats. Listen, I say, my voice trembling with emotion. Have whatever you want, but I'm telling you, I recommend the Diet Pepsi. I look down at my lap, at the blue cloth napkin, the words deck chairs sewn into the napkin's edge, and for a moment think I'm going to cry. My chin trembles and I can't swallow. Courtney reaches over and touches my wrist gently, stroking my Rolex. It's okay, Patrick. It really is. A sharp pain near my liver overcomes the surge of emotion, and I sit up in my chair, startled, confused. And the waiter leaves, and then Anne asks if we've seen the recent David Anika exhibit, and I'm feeling calmer. It turns out we haven't seen the show, But I don't want to be tacky enough to bring up the fact that I own one, so I lightly kick Courtney under the table. This raises her out of her lithium-induced stupor, and she says robotically, "Patrick owns an Anika. He really does." I smile, pleased. Sip my J&B. "Oh, that's fantastic, Patrick," Anne says. "Really? An Anika?" Scott asks. "Isn't he quite expensive?" "Well, let's just say..." I sip my drink, suddenly confused. Say what? "Nothing." Courtney sighs, anticipating another kick. "Patrick's cost $20,000. She seems bored out of her mind, picking out a flat, warm piece of cornbread. I give her a sharp look and try not to hiss. No, Courtney. It was really 50. She slowly looks up from the cornbread she's mashing between her fingers, and even in her lithium haze manages a stare so malicious that it automatically humbles me, but not enough to tell Scott and Anne the truth, that the Anika cost only 12 grand. But Courtney's frightening gaze, though I might be overreacting, she might be staring disapprovingly at the patterns on the columns, the Venetian blinds on the skylight, the Montego vases full of purple tulips lining the bar, scares me enough to not elaborate on the procedure of purchasing an Anika. It's a stare that I can interpret fairly easily. It warns. Kick me again and no pussy, do you understand? "That seems..." Anne starts. I hold my breath, my face tight with tension. "Low," she murmurs. I exhale. "It is, but I got a fabulous deal," I say, gulping. "But 50,000? Scott asks suspiciously. "Well, I think his work, it has a kind of wonderfully proportioned, purposefully mock superficial quality." I pause. Then, trying to remember a line from a review I saw in New York Magazine. "Purposefully mock. Does Lewis own one, Courtney?" Anne asks, and then tapping Courtney's arm. "Courtney? Lewis owns what?" Courtney shakes her head, as if to clear it, widening her eyes to make sure they don't close on her. "Who's Lewis?" Scott asks, waving to the waitress to have the butter the busboy recently placed on the table removed. What a party animal. Anne answers for Courtney. "Her boyfriend," she says after seeing Courtney, confused, actually looking at me for help. "Where's he at?" Scott asks. "Texas," I say quickly. "He's out of town in Phoenix, I mean." "No," Scott says. "I mean, what house?" "L.F. Rothschild," Anne says, about to look at Courtney for confirmation, but then at me. "Right?" "No, he's at P&P, I say. We work together, sort of."
"Wasn't he dating Samantha Stevens at one point?" Anne asks.
"No," Courtney says. "That was just a photo someone took of them. That was in W." I down my drink as soon as it arrives, and wave almost immediately for another, and I'm thinking Courtney is a babe, but no sex is worth this dinner. The conversation violently shifts while I'm staring across the room at a great-looking woman. Blonde, big tits, tight dress, satin pumps with gold cones. When Scott starts telling me about his new compact disc player, while Anne unwittingly prattles on to a stoned and completely oblivious Courtney about new kinds of low-sodium wheat rice cake, fresh fruits, and new-age music, particularly Manhattan Steamroller.
"It's Iowa," Scott's saying. "You've got to hear it. The sound..."
He pauses, closes his eyes in ecstasy, chewing on cornbread.
"Is fantastic."
"Well, you know, Scotty, the Iowa is okay." Oh, holy shit. Dream on, Scotty, I'm thinking. "But Sansui is really top of the line." I pause. Then add, "I should know. I own one."
"But I thought Iowa was top of the line."
Scott looks worried, but not yet upset enough to please me.
"No way, Scott," I say. "Does Iowa have digital remote control?"
"Yeah," he says. Computer controls?
Uh-huh. What a complete and total doofus. Does the system come with a turntable that has a metacrylate and brass platter? Yes. The bastard lies. Does your system have an Acophase T-106 tuner? I ask him. Sure, he says, shrugging. Are you sure? I say. Think carefully. Yeah, I think so, he says. But his hand shakes as it reaches for more of the cornbread. What kind of speakers? Well, Duntech wood, he answers too quickly. So solly, dude. You have to have the Infinity IRS V speakers, I say, or... Wait a minute, he interrupts. V speakers? I've never heard of V speakers. See, that's what I mean, I say. If you don't have the Vs, you might as well be listening to a goddamn Walkman. What's the bass response on those speakers? He asks suspiciously. An ultra-low 15 hertz. I purr, enunciating each word. That shuts him up for a minute. Anne drones on about non-fat frozen yogurt and chow-chows. I sit back, satisfied at having stumped Scott, but too quickly he regains his composure and says, anyway, trying to act blissfully uncaring that he owns a cheap, shitty stereo, we bought the new Phil Collins today. You should hear how great Groovy Kind of Love sounds on it. Yeah, I think it's by far the best song he's written, I say, blah, blah, blah. And though it's finally something Scott and I can agree on, the plates of black and red fish appear, and they look bizarre. And Courtney excuses herself to the ladies' room, and after 30 minutes, when she hasn't reappeared, I wander into the back of the restaurant and find her asleep in the coat check room. But at her apartment, she lies naked on her back, her legs tan and aerobicized, and muscular, and worked out, are spread, and I'm on my knees giving her head while jerking myself off, and in the time since I've started licking and sucking on her pussy, she's already come twice, and her cunt is tight and hot and wet, and I keep it spread open, fingering it with one hand, keeping myself hard with the other. I lift her ass up, wanting to push my tongue into her, but she doesn't want me to, and so I raise up my head and reach over to the portion antique nightstand for the condom that sits in the ashtray from Palio next to the halogen tensor lamp and the Doro pottery urn, and I tear the package open with two shiny slick fingers and my teeth, then slip it easily onto my cock. I want you to fuck me, Courtney moans, pulling her legs back, spreading her vagina even wider, fingering herself, making me suck her fingers, the nails on her hand long and red, and the juice from her cunt glistening in the light coming from the street lamps through the Stuart Hall Venetian blinds. Tastes pink and sweet, and she rubs it over my mouth and lips and tongue before it cools. Yeah, I say, moving on top of her, sliding my dick gracefully into her cunt, kissing her on the mouth hard, pushing into her with long, fast strokes, my cock, my hips crazed, moving on their own desirous momentum. Already my orgasm builds from the base of my balls, my asshole, coming up through my cock, so stiff that it aches. But then in mid-kiss, I lift my head up, leaving her tongue hanging out of her mouth, starting to lick her own red, swollen lips. And while still humping, but lightly now, I realize there is a problem of sorts, but I cannot think of what it is right now. But then it hits me while I'm staring at the half-empty bottle of Evian water on the nightstand, and I gasp, oh, shit, and pull out. What? Courtney moans. Did you forget something? Without answering, I get up from the futon and stumble into her bathroom trying to pull off the condom, but it gets stuck halfway, and while easing it off, I accidentally trip over the gen-old scale, while also trying to flip on the light switch and in the process stubbing my big toe, then, cursing, I manage to open the medicine cabinet. Patrick, what are you doing? She calls from the bedroom. I'm looking for the water-soluble spermicidal lubricant, I call back. What do you think I'm doing? Looking for an Advil? Oh, my God, she cries out. You didn't have any on? Courtney, I call back, noticing a small razor nick above my lip. Where is it? I cannot hear you, Patrick, she calls out. Lewis has a terrible taste in cologne, I mutter, picking up a bottle of Paco Rabanne, sniffing it. "What are you saying?" she cries out. "The water-soluble spermicidal lubricant," I shout back, staring into the mirror, searching her counter for a Clinique touch stick to put over the razor nick. "What do you mean, where is it?" she calls out. "Didn't you have it with you? Where is the goddamn water-soluble spermicidal lubricant?" I scream. "Water-soluble spermicidal lubricant!" I'm shouting this while using some of her Clinique cover-up over the blemish, then combing my hair back. "Top shelf," she says. "I think." While looking through the medicine cabinet, I glance over at her tub, noticing how plain it is, which moves me to say, "You know, Courtney, you should really get your act together and get your tub marbleized, or maybe add some jacuzzi jets," I call out. "Can you hear me, Courtney?" After a long while, she says, "Yes, Patrick, I hear you." I finally find the tube behind a huge bottle, a jar of Xanax, on the top shelf of the medicine cabinet, and before my dick totally softens, place a small dab of it inside the tip of the condom, slather it on the latex sheath, and then walk back into the bedroom, jumping onto the futon, causing her to snap, "Patrick, this is not a fucking trampoline." Ignoring her, I kneel over her body, sliding my cock up into Courtney, and immediately she's pushing her hips up to meet my thrusts, and then she licks her thumb and starts rubbing her clit. I watch as my cock moves in, then out, then into her vagina with long, fast strokes. "Wait," she gasps. "What?" I moan, puzzled, but almost there. "Lewis is a despicable twit," she gasps, trying to push me out of her. "Yes," I say, leaning on top of her, tonguing her ear. "Lewis is a despicable twit. I hate him, too." And now, spurred on by her disgust for her wimp boyfriend, I start moving faster, my climax approaching. "No, you idiot," she groans. "I said, is it a receptacle tip? Not is Lewis a despicable twit. Is it a receptacle tip? Get off me." "Is what a what?" I moan. "Pull out," she groans, struggling. "I'm ignoring you," I say, moving my mouth down on her small, perfect nipples, both of them stiff, sitting on hard, big tits. "Pull out, goddammit," she screams. "What do you want, Courtney?" I grunt, slowing my thrust down until I finally straighten up, and then I'm just kneeling over her, my cock still half inside. She hunches back against the headboard and my dick slides out. "It's a plain end," I point, I think. "Turn the light on," she says, trying to sit up. "Oh, Jesus," I say, "I'm going home." I reach over and flip on the halogen tensor. "It's a plain end, see," I say. "So, take it off," she says curtly. "Why?" I ask. "Because you have to leave half an inch at the tip," she says, covering her breasts with the Hermé comforter, her voice rising, her patience shot, "to catch the force of the ejaculate." "I'm getting out of here," I threaten, "but don't move. Where's your lithium?" She throws a pillow over her head and mumbles something, retreating into a fetal position. I think she's starting to cry. "Where is your lithium, Courtney?" I calmly ask again. "You must take some." Something indecipherable is mumbled again, and she shakes her head, "No, no, no," beneath the pillow. "What? What did you say?" I ask with forced politeness, jerking myself feebly back to an erection. "Where?" Sobs beneath the pillow, barely audible. "You are crying now, and though it sounds clearer to me, I still cannot hear a word you're saying." I try to grab the pillow off her head. "Now speak up!" Again she mumbles, Again, it doesn't make any sense. Courtney, I warn, getting furious, if you just said what I think you said, that your lithium is in a carton in the freezer next to the Frusenglage and is a sorbet... I'm screaming this. If this is really what you said, then I will kill you. Is it a sorbet? Is your lithium really a sorbet? I scream, finally pulling the pillow from her head and slapping her hard once across the face. Do you think you're turning me on by having unsafe sex? She screams back. Oh, Christ, this really isn't worth it, I mutter, pulling the condom down so there is half an inch to spare. A little less, actually. And see, Courtney? It's there for what, huh? Tell us. I slap her again, this time lightly. Why is it pulled down half an inch? So it can catch the force of the ejaculate? Well, it's not a turn-on for me. She's hysterical, racked with tears, choking. I have a promotion coming to me. I'm going to Barbados in August, and I don't want a case of Kaposi sarcoma to fuck it up. She chokes, coughing. Oh, God, I want to wear a bikini, she wails. A normal kamali I just bought at Bergdorf's. I grab her head and force her to look at the placement of the condom. See? Happy, you dumb bitch? Are you happy, you dumb bitch? Without looking at my dick, she sobs.
Oh, God, just get it over with.
And falls back down on the bed. Roughly, I push my cock back into her and bring myself to an orgasm so weak as to be almost non-existent, and my groan of a massive but somewhat expected disappointment is mistaken by Courtney for pleasure and momentarily spurs her on as she lies sobbing beneath me on the bed, sniffling, to reach down and touch herself. But I start getting soft almost instantly. Actually, during the moment I came, but if I don't withdraw from her while still erect, she'll freak out, so I hold on to the base of the condom as I literally wilt out of her. After lying there on separate sides of the bed for what might be 20 minutes, with Courtney whimpering about Lewis and antique cutting boards and the sterling silver cheese grater and muffin tin she left at Harry's, she then tries to give me head. I want to fuck you again, I tell her, but I don't want to wear a condom because I don't feel anything. And she says calmly, taking her mouth off my limp, shrunken dick, glaring at me, if you don't use one, you're not going to feel anything anyway. Business meeting. Jean, my secretary, who is in love with me, walks into my office without buzzing, announcing that I have a very important company meeting to attend at 11. I'm sitting at the Palazzetti glass-top desk, staring into my monitor with my Ray-Bans on, chewing Nuprin, hung over from a Coke binge that started innocently enough last night at Shout with Charles Hamilton, Andrew Spencer, and Chris Stafford, and then moved on to the Princeton Club, progressed to Barcadia, and ended at Nell's around 3:30, and though earlier this morning, while soaking in a bath, sipping a Stoli Bloody Mary after maybe 4 hours of sweaty, dreamless sleep, I realized that there was a meeting. I seem to have forgotten about it on the cab ride downtown. Jean is wearing a red stretch silk jacket, a crocheted rayon ribbon skirt, red suede pumps with satin bows by Susan Bennis Warren Edwards, and gold-plated earrings by Robert Lee Morris. She stands there in front of me, oblivious to my pain, a file in her hand. After pretending to ignore her for close to a minute, I finally lower my sunglasses and clear my throat. Yes? Something else, Jean? Mr. Grouchy today. She smiles, placing the file timidly on my desk, and stands there expecting me to, what, amuse her with vignettes from last night? Yes, you simpleton. I am Mr. Grouchy today, I hiss, grabbing the file and shoving it in the top desk drawer. She stares at me, uncomprehending, then actually looking crestfallen, says, Ted Madison called, and so did James Baker. They want to meet you at Flutie's at 6. I sigh, glaring at her. Well, what should you do? She laughs nervously,
standing there, her eyes wide. I'm not sure. Jean. I stand up to lead her out of the office. What do you say? It takes her a little while, but finally, frightened, she guesses. Just say no. Just say no. I nod, pushing her out and slamming the door. Before leaving my office for the meeting, I take two Valium, wash them down with a Perrier, and then use a scruffing cleanser on my face with pre-moistened cotton balls, afterwards applying a moisturizer. I'm wearing a wool tweed suit and a striped cotton shirt, both by Yves Saint Laurent, and a silk tie by Armani and new black cap-toed shoes by Ferragamo. I plax, then brush my teeth, and when I blow my nose, thick, ropey strings of blood and snot stain a $45 handkerchief from Hermès that, unfortunately, wasn't a gift. But I've been drinking close to 20 liters of Evian water a day and going to the tanning salon regularly, and one night of binging hasn't affected my skin's smoothness or color tone. My complexion is still excellent. Three drops of Visine clear the eyes, an ice pack tightens the skin. All it comes down to is, I feel like shit, but look great. I'm also the first to make it to the boardroom. Lewis Carruthers follows like a puppy dog at my heels, a close second, and takes the seat next to mine, which means I'm supposed to take off my Walkman. He's wearing a wool plaid sports jacket, wool slacks, a Hugo Boss cotton shirt and paisley tie. Slacks, I'm guessing, from Brooks Brothers. He starts rattling on about a restaurant in Phoenix, Profiteers, that I'm actually interested in hearing about, but not from Lewis Carruthers. Yet I'm on 10 milligrams of Valium, and for that reason I can manage. On the Patty Winters show this morning were descendants of members of the Donner Party. The clients were total hicks, predictably, Lewis is saying. They wanted to take me to a local production of Les Mis, which I already saw in London, but did you have any trouble getting reservations at Profiteers? I ask, cutting him off. No, not at all, he says. We ate late. What did you order? I ask. I had the poached oysters, the latte, and walnut tart. I hear the latte is good there, I murmur, lost in thought. The client had the boudin blanc, the roasted chicken, and the cheesecake, he says. Cheesecake? I say, confused by this plain, alien-sounding list. What sauce or fruits were on the roasted chicken? What shapes was it cut into? None, Patrick, he says, also confused. It was roasted. And the cheesecake, what flavor? Was it heated, I say? Ricotta cheesecake? Goat cheese? Were there flowers or cilantro in it? It was just regular, he says. And then, Patrick, you're sweating. What did she have? I ask, ignoring him. The client's bimbo. Well, she had the country salad, the scallops, and the lemon tart, Lewis says. The scallops were grilled? Were they sashimi scallops? In a ceviche of sorts? I'm asking. Or were they gratinized? No, Patrick, Lewis says. They were broiled. It's silent in the boardroom as I contemplate this, thinking it through before asking finally, what's broiled, Lewis? I'm not sure, he says. I think it involves a pan. Wine? I ask. An 85 Sauvignon Blanc, he says. Jordan, two bottles. Car? I ask. Did you rent while in Phoenix? BMW, he smiles. Little black Beamer. Hip, I murmur. Remembering last night how I lost it completely in a stall at Nell's, my mouth foaming, all I could think about were insects. Lots of insects and running at pigeons, foaming at the mouth and running at pigeons. Phoenix. Janet Lee was from Phoenix. I stall, then continue. She got stabbed in the shower. Disappointing scene. I pause. Blood looked fake. Listen, Patrick, Lewis says, pressing his handkerchief into my hand, my fingers clenched into a fist that relaxes at Lewis's touch. Dibble and I are having lunch next week at the Yale Club. Would you like to join us? Sure,
I think about Courtney's legs spread and wrapped around my face. And when I look over at Lewis in one brief flashing moment, his head looks like a talking vagina. And it scares the bejesus out of me, moves me to say something while mopping the sweat off my brow. That's a nice suit, Lewis. The farthest thing from my mind. He looks down as if stunned, and then blushing, embarrassed, he touches his own lapel. Thanks, Pat. You look great, too, as usual. And when he reaches out to touch my tie, I catch his hand before his fingers make it, telling him, your compliment was sufficient. Reed Thompson walks in, wearing a wool plaid, four-button, double-breasted suit and a striped cotton shirt and a silk tie. All Armani. Plus slightly tacky blue cotton socks by Interwoven, and black Ferragamo cap-toe shoes that look exactly like mine, with a copy of the Wall Street Journal held in a nicely manicured fist, and a Bill Kaiserman tweed Balmacan overcoat draped casually across the other arm. He nods and sits across from us at the table. Soon after, Todd Broderick walks in, wearing a wool chalk-striped, six-button, double-breasted suit and a striped broadcloth shirt and silk tie, all by Polo, plus an affected linen pocket square that I'm fairly sure is also by Polo. McDermott walks in next, carrying a copy of this week's New York magazine and this morning's Financial Times, wearing new non-prescription Oliver Peoples redwood-framed glasses, a black and white wool houndstooth check single-breasted suit with notch lapels, a striped cotton dress shirt with spread collar and a silk paisley tie, all of it designed and tailored by John Rail. I smile, raising my eyebrows at McDermott, who sullenly takes the seat next to mine. He sighs and opens the newspaper, silently reading. Since he hasn't offered a hello or good morning, I can tell that he's pissed off, and I suspect that it has something to do with me. Finally, sensing that Lewis is about to ask something, I turn to McDermott. So, McDermott, what's wrong? I smirk. Long line at the Stairmaster this morning? Who said anything's wrong? He asks, sniffing, turning pages in the Financial Times. Listen, I tell him, leaning in. I already apologized about yelling at you because of the pizza at Pastel's the other night. Who said it was about that? He asks tensely. I thought we already cleared this up, I whisper, gripping the arm of his chair, smiling over at Thompson. I'm sorry I insulted the pizzas at Pastel's. Happy? Who said it was about that? He asks again. Then what is it, McDermott? I whisper, noticing movement behind me. I count to three, then whirl around, catching Lewis leaning toward me, trying to eavesdrop. He knows he's been caught, and he sinks slowly back into his chair, guilty. McDermott, this is ridiculous, I whisper. You can't stay angry at me because I think the pizza at Pastel's is crusty. Brittle, he says, shooting me a glance. The word you used was brittle. I apologize, I say, but I'm right. It is. You read the review in the Times, right? Here. He reaches into his pocket and hands me a Xeroxed article. I just wanted to prove you wrong. Read this. What is it? I ask, opening the folded page. It's an article on your hero, Donald Trump, McDermott grins. It sure is, I say apprehensively. Why didn't I ever see this, I wonder? And McDermott scans the article and points an accusatory finger at the bottom paragraph, which he's highlighted in red ink. Where does Donald Trump think the best pizza in Manhattan is served? Let me read this, I sigh, waving him away. You might be wrong. What a lousy photo. Bateman, look. I circled it, he says. I pretend to read the fucking article, but I'm getting very angry, and I have to hand the article back to McDermott and ask, thoroughly annoyed, so what? What does it mean? What are you, McDermott, trying to tell me? What do you think of the pizza at Pastel's now, Bateman? He asks smugly. Well, I say, choosing my words carefully, I think I have to go back and retaste the pizza. I'm saying this through gritted teeth. I'm just suggesting that the last time I was there, the pizza was brittle, McDermott offers. Yeah, I shrug. Brittle.
Uh-huh.
McDermott smiles, triumphant. Listen, if the pizza at Pastel's is okay with Donnie, I start, hating to admit this to McDermott, then sighing almost unintelligibly, it's okay with me. McDermott cackles gleefully, a victor. I count 3 silk crepe ties, 1 Versace silk satin woven tie, 2 silk foulard ties, 1 silk Kenzo, 2 silk jacquard ties. The fragrances of Xerius and Tuscany and Armani and Obsession and Polo and gray flannel and even Antaeus mingle, wafting into each other, rising from the suits and into the air, forming their own mixture, a cold, sickening perfume. But I'm not apologizing, I warn McDermott. You already have, Bateman, he says. Paul Owen walks in, wearing a cashmere one-button sports jacket, tropical wool flannel slacks, a button-down, tab-collared shirt by Rinalda Shamask, but it's really the tie, blue and black and red and yellow bold stripes, from Andrew Fetsa by Zanzara that impresses me. Carruthers gets excited, too, and he leans into my chair and asks, if I'm listening correctly, do you think he has a powered jockstrap to go along with that thing? When I don't answer, he retreats, opens one of the Sports Illustrateds that sit in the middle of the table, and humming to himself, starts to read an article on Olympic divers. Hello, Halberstam, Owen says, walking by. Hello, Owen, I say, admiring the way he's styled and slicked back his hair, with a part so even and sharp it devastates me. And I make a mental note to ask him where he purchases his hair care products, which kind of mousse he uses, my final guess after mulling over the possibilities being 10X. Greg McBride walks in and stops by my chair. Did you watch the winter show this morning? Riot, total riot. And we give each other high five before he takes a seat between Dibble and Lloyd. God knows where they came from. Kevin Forrest, who walks in with Charles Murphy, is saying, my call waiting is busted. Felicia screwed it up somehow. I'm not even paying attention to what they're wearing. But I find myself staring at Murphy's vintage owl cufflinks with blue crystal eyes. Video store, then D'Agostino's. I'm wandering around Video Visions, the video rental store near my apartment on the Upper West Side, sipping from a can of Diet Pepsi, the new Christopher Cross tape blaring from the earphones of my Sony Walkman. After the office, I played racquetball with Montgomery, then had a shiatsu massage and met Jesse Lloyd, Jamie Conway, and Kevin Forrest for drinks at Rusty's on 73rd Street. Tonight, I'm wearing a new wool topcoat by Ungaro Uomo, Paris, and carrying a Bottega Veneta briefcase and an umbrella by Georges Gaspar. The video store is more crowded than usual. There are too many couples in line for me to rent She Male Reformatory or Ginger's Cunt without some sense of awkwardness or discomfort. Plus, I've already bumped into Robert Ailes from First Boston in the horror aisle. Or at least I think it was Robert Ailes. He mumbled, "Hello, McDonald," as he passed me by, holding Friday the 13th, Part 7, and a documentary on abortions in what I noticed were nicely manicured hands, marred only by what looked to me like an imitation gold Rolex. Since pornography seems out of the question, I browse through light comedy and, feeling ripped off, settle for a Woody Allen movie, but I'm still not satisfied. I want something else. I pass through the rock music section. Nothing. Then find myself in horror comedy. Ditto. And suddenly I'm seized by a minor anxiety attack. There are too many fucking movies to choose from. I duck behind a promotional cardboard display for the new Dan Aykroyd comedy and take 2 5-milligram Valiums, washing them down with a Diet Pepsi. Then, almost by rote, as if I've been programmed, I reach for Body Double, a movie I have rented 37 times, and walk up to the counter where I wait for 20 minutes to be checked out by a dumpy girl, 5 pounds overweight, dry, frizzy hair. She's actually wearing a baggy, nondescript sweater, definitely not designer, probably to hide the fact that she has no tits. And even though she has nice eyes, So fucking what?
Finally, it's my turn. I hand her the empty boxes. Is this it? She asks, taking my membership card from me. I'm wearing my Mario Valentino Persian black gloves. My Video Visions membership costs only $250 annually. Do you have any Jamie Gertz movies? I ask her, trying to make direct eye contact. What? She asks, distracted. Any movies that Jamie Gertz is in? Who? She enters something into the computer and then says without looking at me, How many nights? 3, I say. Don't you know who Jamie Gertz is? I don't think so. She actually sighs. Jamie Gertz, I say. She's an actress. I don't think I know who you mean, she says in a tone that suggests I'm harassing her. But hey, she works in a video rental store. And since it's such a demanding, high-powered profession, her bitchy behavior is completely reasonable, right? The things I could do to this girl's body with a hammer, the words I could carve into her with an ice pick. She hands the guy behind her my boxes, and I pretend to ignore his horrified reaction as he recognizes me after he looks at the body double box. Buddy dutifully walks into some kind of vault in the back of the store to get the movies. Yeah, sure you do, I say good-naturedly. She's in those Diet Coke commercials, you know the ones. I really don't think so, she says in a monotone that almost cuts me off. She types the names of the movies and then my membership number into the computer. I like the part in Body Double where the woman gets drilled by the power driller in the movie. The best, I say, almost gasping. It seems very hot in the video store right now all of a sudden. And after murmuring, oh my God, under my breath, I place a gloved hand on the counter to settle it from shaking. And the blood starts pouring out of the ceiling. I take a deep breath, and while I'm saying this, my head starts nodding of its own accord, and I keep swallowing, thinking, I have to see her shoes. And so, as inconspicuously as possible, I try to peer over the counter to check out what kind of shoes she's wearing, but maddeningly, they're only sneakers. Not K-Swiss, not Tretorn, not Adidas, not Reebok. Just cheap ones. Sign here. She hands me the tapes without even looking at me, refusing to recognize who I am. And breathing in hard and exhaling, she motions for the next in line, a couple with a baby. On the way back to my apartment, I stop at D'Agostino's, where for dinner I buy 2 large bottles of Perrier, a 6-pack of Coke Classic, a head of arugula, 5 medium-sized kiwis, a bottle of tarragon balsamic vinegar, a tin of creme fraiche, a carton of microwave tapas, a box of tofu, and a white chocolate candy bar I pick up at the checkout counter. Once outside, ignoring the bum lounging below the Les Miserables poster, and holding a sign that reads, I've lost my job, I am hungry, I have no money, please help, whose eyes tear after I pull the tease the bum with a dollar trick and tell him, Jesus, will you get a fucking shave, please? My eyes, almost like they were guided by radar, focus in on a red Lamborghini Countach parked at the curb, gleaming beneath the street lamps. And I have to stop moving, the Valium shockingly, unexpectedly kicking in. Everything else becomes obliterated. The crying bum, the black kids on crack rapping along to the blaring beatbox, the clouds of pigeons flying overhead looking for space to roost, the ambulance sirens, the honking taxis, the decent-looking babe in the Betsy Johnson dress. All of that fades, and in what seems like time-lapse photography, but in slow motion like a movie. The sun goes down, the city gets darker, and all I can see is the red Lamborghini. And all I can hear is my own even, steady panting. I'm still standing, drooling, in front of the store, staring, minutes later, I don't know how many. Facial. I leave the office at 4:30, head up to Exclusive, where I work out with free weights for an hour, then taxi across the park to Gio's and the Pierre Hotel for a facial, a manicure, and, if time permits, a pedicure. I'm lying on the elevated table in one of the private rooms waiting for Helga, the skin technician, to facialize me. My Brooks Brothers shirt and Garrick Anderson suit hang in the closet. My A. Testoni loafers sit on the floor. $30 socks from Barney's, balled up in them. $60 boxer shorts from Comme des Garçons are the only article of clothing I'm still wearing. The smock I'm supposed to have on is crumpled next to the shower stall since I want Helga to check my body out, notice my chest, see how fucking buff my abdominals have gotten since my last time here, even though she's much older than I am, maybe 30 or 35, and there's no way I'd ever fuck her. I'm sipping a Diet Pepsi that Mario, the valet, brought me, with crushed ice in a glass on the side that I asked for but don't want. I pick up today's post that hangs from a Smithley Watson glass magazine rack and scan the gossip columns. And then my eye catches a story about recent sightings of these creatures that seem to be part bird, part rodent. Essentially, pigeons with the heads and tails of rats, found deep in the center of Harlem and now making their way steadily toward Midtown. A grainy photograph of one of these things accompanies the article, but experts, the Post assures us, are fairly certain this new breed is a hoax. As usual, this fails to soothe my fear, and it fills me with a nameless dread that someone out there has wasted the energy and time to think this up. To fake a photograph, and do a half-assed job at that, the thing looks like a fucking Big Mac, and send the photograph into the Post, then for the Post to decide to run the story, meetings, debates, last-minute temptations to cancel the whole thing, to print the photograph, to have someone write about the photo and interview the experts, finally, to run this story on page 3 in today's edition and have it discussed over hundreds of thousands of lunches in the city this afternoon. I close the paper and lie back, exhausted. The door to the private room opens, and a girl I haven't seen before walks in. And through half-closed eyes, I can see that she's young, Italian, okay-looking. She smiles, sitting in a chair at my feet, and begins the pedicure. She switches off the ceiling light, and except for strategically placed halogen bulbs shining down on my feet, hands, and face, the room darkens, making it impossible to tell what kind of body she has, only that she's wearing gray suede and black leather buttoned ankle boots by Maud Frisson. The Patty Winters show this morning was about UFOs that kill. Helga arrives.
"Ah, Mr. Bateman," Helga says. "How are you?"
"Very good, Helga," I say, flexing the muscles in my stomach and chest. My eyes are closed, so it looks casual, as if the muscles are acting on their own accord and I can't help it. But Helga drapes the smock gently across my heaving chest and buttons it up, pretending to ignore the undulations beneath the tan, clean skin.
"You're back so soon," she says.
"I was only here 2 days ago," I say, confused.
"I know, but..."
She stalls, washing her hands in the sink.
"Never mind."
"Helga?" I ask.
"Yes, Mr. Bateman."
Walking in here, I spotted a pair of men's gold-tasseled loafers from Bergdorf Goodman waiting to be shined outside the door of the next room. "Who do they belong to?" I ask.
"That's Mr. Erlanger," she says.
"Mr. Erlanger from Lehman's?"
"No, Mr. Erlanger from Salomon Brothers," she says.
"Did I ever tell you that I want to wear a big yellow smiley face mask and then put on the CD version of Bobby McFerrin's Don't Worry, Be Happy, and then take a girl and a dog, a collie, a chow, a sharpie, it doesn't matter, and then hook up this transfusion pump, this IV set, and switch their blood, you know, pump the dog's blood into the hard body and vice versa? Did I ever tell you this?" While I'm speaking, I can hear the girl working on my feet, humming one of the songs from Les Miserables to herself. And then Helga runs a moistened cotton ball across my nose, leaning close to the face, inspecting the pores. I laugh maniacally, then take a deep breath and touch my chest, expecting a heart to be thumping quickly, impatiently. But there's nothing there, not even a beat.
"Shh, Mr. Bateman,"
Helga says, running a warm loofah sponge over my face, which stings, then cools the skin.
"Relax."
"Okay," I say. "I'm relaxing."
"Oh, Mr. Bateman," Helga croons, "you have such a nice complexion. How old are you, may I ask?"
"I'm 26.
"Ah, that's why. It's so clean, so smooth," she sighs. "Just relax."
I drift, my eyes rolling back into my head, the Muzak version of Don't Worry Baby drowning out all bad thoughts. And I start thinking only positive things. The reservations I have tonight with Marcus Halberstam's girlfriend, Cecilia Wagner. The mashed turnips at Union Square Cafe. Skiing down Buttermilk Mountain in Aspen last Christmas. The new Huey Lewis and the News compact disc. Dress shirts by Ike Behar. By Joseph Aboud. By Ralph Lauren. Beautiful oiled hard bodies eating each other's pussies and assholes under harsh video lights. Truck roads of arugula and cilantro. My tan line. The way the muscles on my back look when the lights in my bathroom fall on them at the right angle. Helga's hands caressing the smooth skin on my face, lathering and spreading cream and lotions and tonics into it admiringly, whispering, "Oh, Mr. Bateman, your face is so clean and smooth, so clean." The fact that I don't live in a trailer park or work in a bowling alley or attend hockey games or eat barbecued ribs. The look of the AT&T building at midnight, only at midnight. Jeannie comes in and starts the manicure, first clipping and filing the nails, then brushing them with a sandpaper disc to smooth out the remaining edges. "Next time, I prefer them a bit longer, Jeannie," I warn her. Silently, she soaks them in warm lanolin cream, then dries both hands off and uses a cuticle moisturizer, then removes all the cuticles while cleaning under the nails with a cotton-on-wood stick. A heat vibrator massages the hand and forearm. The nails are buffed first with chamois, and then with buffing lotion. Date with Evelyn. Evelyn comes in on the call waiting on my third line, and I wasn't going to take it, but since I'm holding on the second line to find out if Bullock, the maitre d' at the new Davis Francois restaurant on Central Park South, has any cancellations for tonight, so Courtney, holding on the first line, and I might have dinner, I pick it up in the hope that it's my dry cleaners, but no, it's Evelyn. And though it really isn't fair to Courtney, I take her call. I tell Evelyn I'm on the other line with my private trainer. I then tell Courtney I have to take Paul Owens' call and that I'll see her at Turtles at 8, and then I cut myself off from Bullock, the maitre d'. Evelyn's staying at the Carlisle since the woman who lives in the brownstone next to hers was found murdered last night, decapitated. And this is why Evelyn's all shook up. She couldn't deal with the office today, so she spent the afternoon calming herself with facials at Elizabeth Arden. She demands that we have dinner tonight, and then says, before I can make up a plausible lie, an acceptable excuse, "Where were you last night, Patrick?" I pause. "Why? Where were you?" I ask, while guzzling from a liter of Evian, still slightly sweaty from this afternoon's workout. "Arguing with the concierge at the Carlisle," she says, sounding rather pissed off. "Now tell me, Patrick, where were you?" "Why were you arguing with him?" I ask. "Patrick," she says, a declarative statement. "I'm here," I say after a minute. "Patrick." "It doesn't matter. The phone in my room didn't have two lines, and there was no call waiting," she says. "Where were you?" "I was fooling around renting videotapes," I say, pleased, giving myself high five, the cordless phone cradled in my neck. "I wanted to come over," she says in a whiny little girl tone. "I was scared. I still am. Can't you hear it in my voice?"
"Actually, you sound like anything but."
"No, Patrick, seriously. I'm quite terrified," she says. "I'm shaking. Just like a leaf I'm shaking. Ask Mia, my facialist. She said I was tense."
"Well," I say, "you couldn't have come over anyway."
"Honey, why not?"
She whines, and then addresses someone who has just entered her suite.
"Oh, wheel it over there near the window." "No, that window. And can you tell me where that damn masseuse is?"
"Because your neighbor's head was in my freezer," I yawn, stretching. "Listen, dinner? Where? Can you hear me?" At 8:30, the two of us are sitting across from each other in Barcadia. Evelyn's wearing an Anne Klein rayon jacket, a wool crepe skirt, a silk blouse from Bonwitz, antique gold and agate earrings from James Robinson that cost roughly $4,000. And I'm wearing a double-breasted suit, a silk shirt with woven stripes, a patterned silk tie and leather slip-ons, all by Gianni Versace. I neither canceled the reservation at Turtles nor told Courtney not to meet me there, so she'll probably show up around 8:15, completely confused. And if she hasn't taken any Elavil today, she'll probably be furious, and it's this fact, not the bottle of Cristal that Evelyn insists on ordering and then adds cassis to, that I laugh out loud about. I spent most of the afternoon buying myself early Christmas presents. A large pair of scissors at a drugstore near City Hall, a letter opener from Hammacher Schlemmer, a cheese knife from Bloomingdale's to go along with the cheese board that Jean, my secretary who's in love with me, left on my desk before she went to lunch while I was in a meeting. The Patty Winter show this morning was about the possibility of nuclear war, and according to the panel of experts, the odds are pretty good it will happen sometime within the next month. Evelyn's face seems chalky to me right now, her mouth lined with a purple lipstick that gives off an almost startling effect, and I realize that she's belatedly taken Tim Price's advice to stop using her tanning lotion. Instead of mentioning this and have her bore me silly with inane denials, I ask about Tim's girlfriend, Meredith, whom Evelyn despises for reasons never made quite clear to me, and because of rumors about Courtney and myself, Courtney is also on Evelyn's shit list for reasons that are a little clearer. I place a hand over the top of the champagne flute when the apprehensive waitress, at Evelyn's request, attempts to add some blueberry cassis into my Cristal. No, thank you, I tell her. Maybe later, in a separate glass.
Party pooper,
Evelyn giggles, then takes a sharp breath.
But you smell nice. What are you wearing? Obsession?
You party pooper, is it obsession?
No,
I say grimly. Paul Sebastian.
Of course.
She smiles, downs her second glass. She seems in a much better mood, boisterous almost. More than you'd expect of someone whose neighbor's head was sliced off in a matter of seconds while she was still conscious by an electric mini chainsaw. Evelyn's eyes momentarily glitter in the candlelight, then revert to their normal pallid gray. How is Meredith? I ask, trying to mask my void of disinterest.
Oh, God. She's dating Richard Cunningham,
Evelyn moans. He's at First Boston, if you can believe it. I know, I mention. Tim was going to break it off with her, call it quits.
Why, for God's sake?
Evelyn asks, surprised, intrigued.
They had that fabulous place in the Hamptons.
I remember him telling me that he was sick to death of watching her do nothing but her nails all weekend.
Oh, my God,
Evelyn says, and then genuinely confused.
You mean, wait, she didn't have someone do them for her?
Tim said, and he reiterated this fact quite often, that she had all the personality of a game show host, I say dryly, sipping from the flute. She smiles to herself secretly.
Tim is a rascal.
Idly, I wonder if Evelyn would sleep with another woman if I brought one over to her brownstone, and if I insisted, whether they'd let me watch the two of them get it on. If they'd let me direct, tell them what to do, position them under hot halogen lamps. Probably not. The odds don't look good. But what if I forced her at gunpoint? Threatened to cut them both up, maybe, if they didn't comply. The thought doesn't seem unappealing, and I can imagine the whole scenario quite clearly. I start counting the banquets that encircle the room. Then I start counting the people sitting in the banquets. She's asking me about Tim.
Where do you think that rascal has been?
Rumor is he's at Saks, she says ominously. Rumor is, I say, he's in rehab. The champagne isn't cold enough. I'm distracted. Doesn't he send you postcards?
Has he been sick?
She asks, with the slightest trepidation. Yes, I think so, I say. I think that's what it is. You know, if you order a bottle of Cristal, it should be at least, you know, cold.
Oh, my God, Evelyn says. You think he might be sick?
Yes, he's in a hospital in Arizona, I add. The word Arizona has a mysterious tinge to it, and I say it again. Arizona, I think.
Oh, my God! Evelyn exclaims, now truly alarmed, and she gulps down what little cristal is left in her glass. Who knows? I manage the slightest of shrugs.
You don't think... She breathes in and puts her glass down. You don't think it's...
And now she looks around the restaurant before leaning in, whispering.
AIDS.
Oh, no, nothing like that, I say, though immediately I wish I had paused long enough before answering to scare her. Just general brain. I bite the tip off an herb breadstick and shrug. Injuries.
Evelyn sighs, relieved, and then says, is it warm in here?
All I can think about is this poster I saw on the subway station the other night before I killed those two black kids. A photo of a baby calf, its head turned toward the camera, its eyes caught wide and staring by the flash, and its body seemed like it was boxed into some kind of crate. And in big black letters below the photo it read, question, why can't this veal calf walk? Then, answer, because it only has two legs. But then I saw another one, this exact same photo, the same exact calf, yet beneath it, this one read, stay out of publishing. I pause, still fingering the breadstick, then ask, is any of this registering with you, or would I get more of a response from, oh, an ice bucket? I say all of this staring straight at Evelyn, enunciating precisely, trying to explain myself. And she opens her mouth, and I finally expect her to acknowledge my character. And for the first time since I've known her, she is straining to say something interesting, and I pay very close attention, and she asks, is that... Yes? This is the only moment of the evening where I feel any genuine interest toward what she has to say, and I urge her to go on.
Yes? Is that... Is that... Ivana Trump?
She asks, peering over my shoulder. I whirl around. Where? Where's Ivana?
In the booth near the front, second from...
Evelyn pauses.
Brooke Astor, see?
I squint, put on my Oliver Peoples non-prescription glasses, and realize that Evelyn, her vision clouded by the cassis-riddled crystal, not only has mistaken Norris Powell for Ivana Trump, but has mistaken Steve Rubell for Brooke Astor, and I can't help it. I almost explode.
No! Oh, my God! Oh, my God, Evelyn! I moan, crushed. Disappointed, my adrenaline rush turning sour, my head in my hands. How could you mistake that wench for Ivana?
Sorry, I hear her chirp. Girlish mistake.
That is infuriating,
I hiss, both eyes clenched tight.
Our hard-body waitress, who has on satin high-backed pumps, sets down two new champagne flutes for the second bottle of Cristal Evelyn orders.
The waitress pouts her lips at me when I reach for another breadstick, and I lift my head toward her and pout mine back, then press my head again into the palms of my hands, and this happens again when she brings our appetizers. Dried peppers and a spicy pumpkin soup for me, dried corn and jalapeno pudding for Evelyn. I've kept my hands over both ears trying to block out Evelyn's voice during this whole interim between her mistaking Norris Powell for Ivana Trump and the arrival of our appetizers, but now I'm hungry, so I tentatively remove my right hand from my ear. Immediately, the wine seems deafening. Tandoori chicken and foie gras and lots of jazz, and he adored the Savoy, but shad roe. The colors were gorgeous. Aloe, shell, citrus, Morgan Stanley. I clasp my hands back where they were, pressing even tighter. Once again, hunger overtakes me, and so, humming loudly to myself, I reach again for the spoon, but it's hopeless. Evelyn's voice is at a particular pitch that cannot be ignored. Gregory's graduating from St. Paul soon and will be attending Columbia in September, Evelyn is saying, carefully blowing on her pudding, which, by the way, is served cold. And I've got to get him a graduation present, and I'm at a total loss. Suggestions, hon?
A poster from Les Miserables, I sigh, only half-joking.
Perfect, she says, blowing on the pudding again. Then, after a sip of Cristal, she makes a face.
Yes, dear, I ask, spitting a pumpkin seed that arches through the air before gracefully hitting the dead center of the ashtray instead of Evelyn's dress, my original target.
Hmm? We need more cassis, she says. Will you get our waitress?
Of course we do. I say good-naturedly, and still smiling, I have no idea who Gregory is. You do know that, right? Evelyn puts her spoon down delicately next to the plate of pudding and looks into my eyes. Mr. Bateman, I really like you. I adore your sense of humor. She gives my hand a soft squeeze and laughs. Actually says, ha, ha, ha. But she's serious, not joking. Evelyn really is paying me a compliment. She does admire my sense of humor. Our appetizers are removed, and at the same time our entrees arrive, so Evelyn has to take her hand off mine to make room for the plates. She ordered quail stuffed into blue corn tortillas, garnished with oysters and potato skins. I have the free-range rabbit with Oregon morels and herbed French fries. He went to Deerfield, then Harvard. She went to Hotchkiss, then Radcliffe. Evelyn is talking, but I'm not listening. Her dialogue overlaps her own dialogue. Her mouth is moving, but I'm not hearing anything, and I can't listen. I can't really concentrate, since my rabbit has been cut to look just like a star. Shoestring French fries surrounding it, and chunky red salsa has been smeared across the top of the plate, which is white and porcelain and 2 feet wide to give the appearance of a sunset, but it looks like one big gunshot wound to me. And shaking my head slowly in disbelief, I press a finger into the meat, leaving the indentation of one finger, then another. And then I look for a napkin, but not my own, to wipe my hand with. Evelyn hasn't broken her monologue. She talks and chews exquisitely. And smiling seductively at her, I reach under the table and grab her thigh, wiping my hand off. And still talking, she smiles naughtily at me and sips more champagne. I keep studying her face, bored by how beautiful it is, flawless, really. And I think to myself, how strange it is that Evelyn has pulled me through so much. How she's always been there when I needed her most. I look back at the plate, thoroughly unhungry, pick up my fork, study the plate hard for a minute or two, whimper to myself before sighing and putting the fork down. I pick up my champagne glass instead. Groton, Lawrenceville, Milton, Exeter, Kent, St. Paul's, Hotchkiss, Andover, Milton, Choate. Oops, already said Milton. If I'm not eating this tonight, and I'm not, I want some cocaine, I announce. But I haven't interrupted Evelyn. She's unstoppable, a machine, and she continues talking. Jane Simpson's wedding was so beautiful, she sighs. And the reception afterwards was wild. Club Chernobyl, covered by Page Six, Billy covered it. WWD did a layout. I heard there was a 2-drink minimum, I say warily, signaling for a nearby busboy to remove my plate. Weddings are so romantic. She had a diamond engagement ring. You know, Patrick, I won't settle for less. She says coyly, it has to be a diamond. Her eyes glaze over it, and she tries to recount the wedding in mind-numbing detail. It was a sit-down dinner for 500. No, excuse me, 750, followed by a 16-foot tiered Ben and Jerry's ice cream cake. The gown was by Ralph, and it was white lace and low-cut and sleeveless. It was darling. Oh, Patrick, what would you wear? She sighs. I would demand to wear Ray-Ban sunglasses. Expensive Ray-Bans, I say carefully. In fact, I would demand that everyone would have to wear Ray-Ban sunglasses. I'd want a Zydeco band, Patrick. That's what I'd want. A Zydeco band. She gushes breathlessly. Or mariachi. Or reggae. Something ethnic to shock Daddy. Oh, I can't decide. I'd want to bring a Harrison AK-47 assault rifle to the ceremony, I say, bored, in a rush, with a 30-round magazine, so after thoroughly blowing your fat mother's head off with it, I could use it on that fag brother of yours. And though personally I don't like to use anything the Soviets designed, I don't know, the Harrison somehow reminds me of... Stopping, confused, inspecting yesterday's manicure, I look back at Evelyn. Stoli? Oh, and lots of chocolate truffles. Godiva. And oysters. Oysters on the half shell. Marzipan. Pink tents. Hundreds, thousands of roses. Photographers. Annie Leibovitz. We'll get Annie Leibovitz, she says excitedly. And we'll hire someone to videotape it. Or an AR-15. You'd like it, Evelyn. It's the most expensive of guns, but worth every penny. I wink at her, but she's still talking. She doesn't hear a word. Nothing registers. She does not fully grasp a word I'm saying. My essence is eluding her. She stops her onslaught and breathes in and looks at me in a way that can only be described as dewy-eyed. Touching my hand, my Rolex, she breathes in once more, this time expectantly, and says, "We should do it." I'm trying to catch a glimpse of our hard-body waitress. She's bending over to pick up a drop napkin. Without looking back at Evelyn, I ask, "Do what?"
"Get married," she says, blinking. "Have a wedding."
"Evelyn?"
"Yes, darling."
"Is your keyer spiked?" I ask.
"We should do it," she says softly. "Patrick."
"Are you proposing to me?" I laugh, trying to fathom this reasoning. I take the champagne glass away from her and sniff its rim.
"Patrick?"
she asks, waiting for my answer. "Geez, Evelyn," I say, stuck. "I don't know."
"Why not?"
she asks, petulantly. "Give me one good reason we shouldn't. Because trying to fuck you is like trying to French kiss a very small and lively gerbil," I tell her. "I don't know."
"Yes," she says.
"And with braces?" I finish, shrugging. "What are you going to do?" she asks. "Wait 3 years until you're 30?
4 years, I say, glaring. "It's 4 years until I'm 30.
4 years, 3 years, 3 months. Oh, God, what's the difference? You'll still be an old man." She takes her hand away from mine.
"You know, you wouldn't be saying this if you'd been to Jane Simpson's wedding. You'd take one look at it and want to marry me immediately."
"But I was at Jane Simpson's wedding, Evelyn, love of my life," I say. "I was seated next to Sukrit Gable. Believe me, I was there."
"You're impossible," she whines. "You're a party pooper."
"Or maybe I didn't," I wonder aloud. "Maybe I... was it covered by MTV?
And their honeymoon was so romantic. 2 hours later, they were on the Concorde to London."
"Oh, Claridge's," Evelyn sighs, her hand clasped under her chin, eyes tearing. Ignoring her, I reach into my pocket for a cigar, pull it out and tap it against the table. Evelyn orders 3 flavors of sorbet, peanut, licorice, and donut. I ordered a decaffeinated espresso. Evelyn sulks. I light a match.
"Patrick," she warns, staring at the flame.
"What?" I ask, my hand frozen in midair, about to light the tip of the cigar.
"You didn't ask permission,"
she says, unsmiling. "Did I tell you I'm wearing my $60 boxer shorts?" I ask, trying to appease her. Tuesday. There's a black tie party at the Puck Building tonight for a new brand of computerized professional rowing machine. And after playing squash with Frederick Dibble, I have drinks at Harry's with Jamie Conway, Kevin Wynn, and Jason Gladwin, and we hop into the limousine Kevin rented for the night and take it uptown. I'm wearing a wing-collared jacquard waistcoat by Kilgore, French, and Stanbury from Barney's, a silk bow tie from Saks, patent leather slip-ons by Baker Benjes, antique diamond studs from Kentshire Galleries, and a gray wool silk-lined coat with drop sleeve and a button-down collar by Luciano Soprani. An ostrich wallet from Bosca carries $400 cash in the back pocket of my black wool trousers. Instead of my Rolex, I'm wearing a 14-karat gold watch from H. Stern. I wander aimlessly around the Puck Building's first-floor ballroom board, sipping bad champagne. Could it be non-vintage Bollinger? From plastic flutes, chewing on kiwi slices, each topped with a dollop of Chev, vaguely looking around to score some cocaine. Instead of finding anyone who knows a dealer, I bump into Courtney by the stairs. Wearing a silk and cotton stretch tulle body wrap with jeweled lace pants, she seems tense and warns me to stay away from Lewis. She mentions that he suspects something. A cover band plays lame versions of old Motown hits from the 60s.
"Like what?"
I ask, scanning the room. "That 2 + 2 = 4? That you're secretly Nancy Reagan?"
"Don't have lunch with him next week at the Yale Club," she says, smiling for a photographer, the flash blinding us momentarily.
"You look voluptuous tonight," I say, touching her neck, running a finger up over her chin until it reaches the bottom lip.
"I'm not joking, Patrick."
Smiling, she waves to Lewis, who is dancing clumsily with Jennifer Morgan.
He's wearing a cream-colored wool dinner jacket, wool trousers, a cotton shirt, and a silk Glen plaid cummerbund, all from Hugo Boss, a bow tie from Saks, and a pocket square from Paul Stewart. He waves back. I give him thumbs up.
What a dork,
Courtney whispers sadly to herself. Listen, I'm leaving, I say, finishing the champagne. Why don't you go dance with the receptacle tip?
Where are you going?
She asks, gripping my arm. Courtney, I don't want to experience another one of your emotional outbursts, I tell her. Besides, the canapes are shitty.
Where are you going?
She asks again.
Details, Mr. Bateman.
Why are you so concerned?
Because I'd like to know, she says.
You're not going to Evelyn's, are you?
Maybe,
I lie.
Patrick, she says, don't leave me here. I don't want you to go.
I have to return some videos, I lie again, handing her my empty champagne glass, just as another camera flashes somewhere. I walk away. The band segues into a rousing version of Life in the Fast Lane, and I start looking around for hard bodies. Charles Simpson, or someone who looks remarkably like him, slick back hair, suspenders, all over people's glasses, shakes my hand, shouts, "Hey, Williams!" and tells me to meet a group of people with Alexandra Craig at Nell's around midnight. I give him a reassuring squeeze on the shoulder and tell him I'll be there. Outside, smoking a cigar, contemplating the sky, I spot Reed Thompson, who emerges from the Puck building with his entourage, Jamie Conway, Kevin Wynn, Marcus Halberstam, no babes, and invites me along to dinner. And though I suspect they have drugs, I have misgivings about spending the evening with them and decide not to trek up to that Salvadorian bistro, especially since they don't have reservations and aren't guaranteed a table. I wave them off, then cross Houston, dodging other limos leaving the party, and start moving uptown. Walking along Broadway, I stop at an automated teller where, just for the hell of it, I take out another $100, feeling better having an even $500 in my wallet. I find myself walking through the antique district below 14th Street. My watch has stopped, so I'm not sure what time it is, but probably 10:30 or so. Black guys pass by, offering crack or hustling tickets to a party at the Palladium. I walk by a newsstand, a dry cleaner's, a church, a diner. The streets are empty. The only noise breaking up the silence is an occasional taxi cruising toward Union Square. A couple of skinny faggots walk by while I'm at a phone booth checking my messages, staring at my reflection in an antique store's window. One of them whistles at me. The other laughs. A high, fey, horrible sound. A torn playbill from Les Miserables tumbles down the cracked, urine-stained sidewalk. A street lamp burns out. Someone in a Jean-Paul Gaultier topcoat takes a piss in an alleyway. Steam rises from below the streets, billowing up in tendrils, evaporating. Bags of frozen garbage line the curbs. The moon, pale and low, hangs just above the tip of the Chrysler building. Somewhere, from over in the West Village, the siren from an ambulance screams. The wind picks it up. It echoes, then fades. The bum, a black man, lies in the doorway of an abandoned antique store on 12th Street, on top of an open grate, surrounded by bags of garbage and a shopping cart from Gristiti's, loaded with what I suppose are personal belongings. Newspapers, bottles, aluminum cans. A hand-painted cardboard sign attached to the front of the cart reads, "I am hungry and homeless, please help me." A dog, a small mutt, short-haired and rail-thin, lies next to him, its makeshift leash tied to the handle of the grocery cart. I didn't notice the dog the first time I passed by. It's only after I circle the block and come back that I see it lying on a pile of newspapers, guarding the bum, a collar around its neck with an oversized nameplate that reads, Gizmo. The dog looks up at me, wagging its skinny, pathetic excuse for a tail. When I hold out a gloved hand, it licks at it hungrily. The stench of some kind of cheap alcohol, mixed with excrement, hangs here like a heavy, invisible cloud, and I have to hold my breath before adjusting to the stink. The bum wakes up, opens his eyes, yawning, exposing remarkably stained teeth between cracked purple lips. He's 40-ish, heavy-set, and when he attempts to sit up, I can make out his features more clearly in the glare of the street lamp. A few days' growth of beard, triple chin, a ruddy nose lined with thick brown veins. He's dressed in some kind of tacky-looking lime-green polyester pantsuit, with washed-out Sergio Valente jeans worn over it, this season's homeless person's fashion statement, along with a ripped orange and brown V-neck sweater stained with what looks like burgundy wine. He seems very drunk. Either that or he's crazy or stupid. His eyes can't even focus when I stand over him, blocking out the light from a street lamp, covering him in shadow. I kneel down. "Hello," I say, offering my hand, the one the dog licked. "Pat Bateman." The bum stares at me, panting with the exertion it takes to sit up. He doesn't shake my hand. "You want some money?" I ask gently. "Some food?" The bum nods and starts to cry, thankfully. I reach into my pocket and pull out a $10 bill, then change my mind, and hold out a $5 instead. "Is this what you need?" The bum nods again and looks away, shamefully, his nose running, and after clearing his throat says quietly, "I'm so hungry." "It's cold out, too," I say, "isn't it?"
"I'm so hungry."
He convulses once, twice, a third time, then looks away, embarrassed. "Why don't you get a job?" I ask, the bill still held in my hand, but not within the bum's reach. "If you're so hungry, why don't you get a job?" He breathes in, shivering, and between sobs admits,
"I lost my job."
"Why?" I ask, genuinely interested. "Were you drinking? Is that why you lost it? Insider trading?" "Just joking. No, really, were you drinking on the job?" He hugs himself between sobs, chokes.
"I was fired. I was laid off."
I take this in, nodding. "Gee, that's too bad."
"I'm so hungry,"
he says, and starts crying hard, still holding himself. His dog, the thing called Gizmo, starts whimpering. "Why don't you get another one?" I ask. "Why don't you get another job?"
"I'm not..."
he coughs, holding himself, shaking miserably, violently, unable to finish the sentence.
"You're not what?"
I ask softly. "Qualified for anything else?"
"I'm hungry,"
he whispers. "I know that. I know that," I say. "Geez, you're like a broken record. I'm trying to help you." My impatience rises.
"I'm hungry,"
he repeats. "Listen, do you think it's fair to take money from people who do have jobs, who do work?" His face crumples and he gasps, his voice raspy.
"What am I gonna do?"
"Listen," I say. "What's your name?"
"Al,"
he says. "Speak up," I tell him. "Come on."
"Al,"
he says, a little louder. "Get a goddamn job, Al," I say earnestly. "You've got a negative attitude. That's what's stopping you. You've got to get your act together. I'll help you."
"You're so kind, mister. You're kind. You're a kind man,"
he blubbers.
"I can tell."
"Shh," I whisper. "It's okay." I start petting the dog.
"Please,"
he says, grabbing for my wrist.
"I don't know what to do. I'm so cold."
"You know how bad you smell?" I whisper this soothingly, stroking his face. "The stench. My God."
"I can't."
He chokes and swallows.
"I can't find a shelter."
"You reek," I tell him. "You reek of shit." I'm still petting the dog, its eyes wide and wet and grateful. "Do you know that, God damn it? Al, look at me. Stop crying like some kind of faggot," I shout. My rage builds, subsides, and I close my eyes, bringing my hand up to squeeze the bridge of my nose. Then I sigh. "Al, I'm sorry. It's just that, I don't know. I don't have anything in common with you." The bum's not listening. He's crying so hard he's incapable of a coherent answer. I put the bill slowly back into the pocket of my Luciano Soprani jacket, and with the other hand stop petting the dog and reach into the other pocket. The bum stops sobbing abruptly and sits up, looking for the fiver, or, I presume, his bottle of Thunderbird.
I reach out and touch his face gently once more with compassion and whisper, "Do you know what a fucking loser you are?" He starts nodding helplessly, and I pull out a long, thin knife with a serrated edge. And being very careful not to kill him, push maybe half an inch of the blade into his right eye, flicking the handle up, instantly popping the retina. The bum is too surprised to say anything. He only opens his mouth in shock and moves a grubby, mittened hand slowly up to his face. I yank his pants down, and in the passing headlights of a taxi, can make out his flabby black thighs, rashed because of his constantly urinating in the pantsuit. The stench of shit rises quickly into my face, and breathing through my mouth, down on my haunches, I start stabbing him in the stomach lightly, above the dense, matted patch of pubic hair. This sobers him up somewhat, and instinctively he tries to cover himself with his hands, and the dog starts yipping, really furiously, but it doesn't attack. And I keep stabbing at the bum now, between his fingers, stabbing the backs of his hands. His eye, burst open, hangs out of its socket and runs down his face, and he keeps blinking, which causes what's left of it inside the wound to pour out like red, veiny egg yolk. I grab his head with one hand and push it back, and then with my thumb and forefinger, hold the other eye open and bring the knife up and push the tip of it into the socket, first breaking its protective film so the socket fills with blood, then slitting the eyeball open sideways, and he finally starts screaming once I slit his nose in two, lightly spraying me and the dog with blood, Gizmo blinking to get the blood out of his eyes. I quickly wipe the blade clean across the bum's face, breaking open the muscle above his cheek. Still kneeling, I throw a quarter in his face, which is slick and shiny with blood, both sockets hollowed out and filled with gore, what's left of his eyes literally oozing over his screaming lips in thick, webby strands. Calmly, I whisper, "There's a quarter. Go buy some gum, you fucking crazy nigger." Then I turn to the barking dog, and when I get up, stomp on its front legs while it's crouched down, ready to jump at me, its fangs bared, immediately shattering the bones in both its legs, and it falls on its side, squealing in pain, front paws sticking up in the air at an obscene, satisfying angle. I can't help but start laughing, and I linger at the scene, amused by this tableau. When I spot an approaching taxi, I slowly walk away. Afterwards, two blocks west, I feel heady, ravenous, pumped up, as if I'd just worked out, and endorphins are flooding my nervous system, or just embraced that first line of cocaine, inhaled the first puff of a fine cigar, sipped that first glass of Cristal. I'm starving, need something to eat, but I don't want to stop by Nell's. Though I'm within walking distance, and Indochine seems an unlikely place for a celebratory drink, so I decide to go somewhere Al would go, the McDonald's in Union Square. Standing in the line, I order a vanilla shake, extra thick, I warn the guy, who just shakes his head and flips on a machine, and take it to a table up front where Al would probably sit, my jacket and its sleeves slightly spattered with flecks of his blood. Two waitresses from the Cat Club walk in after me and sit in the booth across from mine, both smiling flirtatiously. I play it cool and ignore them. An old crazy woman, wrinkled, chain-smoking, sits near us, nodding at no one. A police car passes by, and after two more milkshakes, my high slowly dissolves, its intensity diminishing. I grow bored, tired. The evening seems horribly anticlimactic, and I start cursing myself for not going to that Salvadorian bistro with Reed Thompson and the guys. The two girls linger, still interested. I check my watch. One of the Mexicans working behind the counter stares at me while smoking a cigarette, and he studies the stains on the Soprani jacket in a way that suggests he's going to say something about it. But a customer comes in, one of the black guys who tried to sell me crack earlier, and he has to take the black guy's order. So the Mexican puts out his cigarette. That's what he does. Genesis. I've been a big Genesis fan ever since the release of their 1980 album, Duke. Before that, I didn't really understand any of their work, though on their last album of the 1970s, the concept-laden And Then There Were Three, a reference to band member Peter Gabriel, who left the group to start a lame solo career, I did enjoy the lovely Follow You, Follow Me,
Otherwise, all the albums before Duke seemed too artsy, too intellectual. It was Duke, Atlantic, 1980, where Phil Collins' presence became more apparent, and the music got more modern. The drum machine became more prevalent, and the lyrics started getting less mystical and more specific, maybe because of Peter Gabriel's departure. And complex, ambiguous studies of loss became instead smashing first-rate pop songs that I gratefully embraced. The songs themselves seemed arranged more around Collins' drumming than Mike Rutherford's bass lines or Tony Banks' keyboard riffs. A classic example of this is Misunderstanding, which not only was the group's first big hit of the 80s, but also seemed to set the tone for the rest of their albums as the decade progressed. The other standout on Duke is Turn It On Again, which is about the negative effects of television. On the other hand, Heat Haze is a song I just don't understand, while Please Don't Ask is a touching love song written to a separated wife who regains custody of the couple's child. Has the negative aspect of divorce ever been rendered in more intimate terms by a rock and roll group? I don't think so. Duke Travels and Duke's End might mean something, but since the lyrics aren't printed, it's hard to tell what Collins is singing about. Though there is complex, gorgeous piano work by Tony Banks on the latter track, the only bummer about Duke is Alone Tonight, which is way too reminiscent of Tonight, 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 from the group's later masterpiece, Invisible Touch, and the only example, really, of where Collins has plagiarized himself. Abacab, Atlantic, 1981, was released almost immediately after Duke, and it benefits from a new producer, Hugh Padgham, who gives the band a more 80s sound, and though the songs seem fairly generic, there are still great bits throughout. The extended jam in the middle of the title track, and the horns by some group called Earth, Wind, and Fire on No Reply at All, are just two examples. Again, the songs reflect dark emotions and are about people who feel lost or who are in conflict. But the production and sound are gleaming and upbeat, even if the titles aren't. No Reply at All, Keep It Dark, Who Done It, Like It or Not. Mike Rutherford's bass is obscured somewhat in the mix, but otherwise, the band sounds tight and is once again propelled by Collins' truly amazing drumming. Even at its most despairing, like the song Dodo about extinction, Abacab musically is poppy and lighthearted. My favorite track is Man on the Corner, which is the only song credited solely to Collins, a moving ballad with a pretty synthesized melody, plus a riveting drum machine in the background. Though it could easily come off any of Phil's solo albums, because the themes of loneliness, paranoia, and alienation are overly familiar to Genesis, it evokes the band's hopeful humanism. Man on the Corner profoundly equates a relationship with a solitary figure, a bum perhaps, a poor homeless person, that lonely man on the corner who just stands around. Who Done It profoundly expresses the theme of confusion against a funky groove, and what makes this song so exciting is that it ends with its narrator never finding anything out at all. Hugh Padgham produced next an even less conceptual effort, simply called Genesis, Atlantic, 1983, and though it's a fine album, a lot of it now seems too derivative for my tastes. That's All sounds like Misunderstanding. Taking It All Too Hard reminds me of Throwing It All Away. It also seems less jazzy than its predecessors, and more of an 80s pop album, more rock and roll. Padgham does a brilliant job of producing, but the material is weaker than usual, and you can sense the strain. It opens with the autobiographical Mama. That's both strange and touching, though I couldn't tell if the singer was talking about his actual mother or to a girl he likes to call Mama. That's All is a lover's lament about being ignored and beaten down by an unreceptive partner. Despite the despairing tone, it's got a bright sing-song melody that makes the song less depressing than it probably needs to be. That's All is the best tune on the album, but Phil's voice is strongest on House by the Sea, whose lyrics are, however, too stream of consciousness to make much sense. It might be about growing up and accepting adulthood, but it's unclear. At any rate, its second instrumental part puts the song more in focus for me, and Mike Banks gets to show off his virtuosic guitar skills, while Tom Rutherford washes the tracks over with dreamy synthesizers, and when Phil repeats the song's third verse at the end, it can give you chills. Illegal Alien is the most explicitly political song the group has yet recorded, and their funniest.
The subject is supposed to be sad, a wetback trying to get across the border into the United States. But the details are highly comical. The bottle of tequila the Mexican holds, the new pair of shoes he's wearing, probably stolen. And it all seems totally accurate. Phil sings it in a brash, whiny, pseudo-Mexican voice that makes it even funnier. And the rhyme of fun with illegal alien is inspired. Just a Job to Do is the album's funkiest song with a killer bass line by Banks. And though it seems to be about a detective chasing a criminal, I think it could also be about a jealous lover tracking someone down. Silver Rainbow is the album's most lyrical song. The words are intense, complex, and gorgeous. The album ends on a positive, upbeat note with "It's gonna get better." Even if the lyrics seem a tiny bit generic to some, Phil's voice is so confident, heavily influenced by Peter Gabriel, who never made an album this polished and heartfelt himself, that he makes us believe in glorious possibilities. Invisible Touch, Atlantic 1986, is the group's undisputed masterpiece. It's an epic meditation on intangibility. At the same time, it deepens and enriches the meaning of the preceding three albums. It has a resonance that keeps coming back at the listener. And the music is so beautiful that it's almost impossible to shake off, because every song makes some connection about the unknown or the spaces between people. Invisible Touch, questioning authoritative control, whether by domineering lovers or by government. Land of Confusion, or by meaningless repetition, tonight, tonight, tonight. All in all, it ranks with the finest rock and roll achievements of the decade, and the mastermind behind this album, along, of course, with the brilliant ensemble playing of Banks, Collins, and Rutherford, is Hugh Padgham, who has never found as clear and crisp and modern a sound as this. You can practically hear every nuance of every instrument. In terms of lyrical craftsmanship and sheer songwriting skills, this album hits a new peak of professionalism. Take the lyrics to Land of Confusion, in which a singer addresses the problem of abusive political authority. This is laid down with a groove funkier and blacker than anything Prince or Michael Jackson, or any other black artist of recent years for that matter, has come up with. Yet, as danceable as the album is, it also has a stripped-down urgency that not even the overrated Bruce Springsteen can equal. As an observer of Love's failings, Collins beats out the boss again and again, reaching new heights of emotional honesty on In Too Deep, yet it also showcases Collins' clowny, prankish, unpredictable side. It's the most moving pop song of the 1980s about monogamy and commitment. Anything She Does, which echoes the Jay Giles Band's Centerfold, but is more spirited and energetic, starts off side two, and after that the album reaches its peak with Domino, a two-part song. Part one, In the Heat of the Night, is full of sharp, finely drawn images of despair, and it's paired with The Last Domino, which fights it with an expression of hope. This song is extremely uplifting. The lyrics are as positive and affirmative as anything I've heard in rock. Phil Collins' solo efforts seem to be more commercial and therefore more satisfying in a narrower way, especially No Jacket Required, and songs like In the Air Tonight and Against All Odds, though that song was overshadowed by the masterful movie from which it came, and Take Me Home and Sussudio, great, great song, a personal favorite, and his remake of You Can't Hurry Love, which I'm not alone in thinking is better than the Supremes' original. But I also think that Phil Collins works better within the confines of the group than as a solo artist. And I stress the word artist. In fact, it applies to all three of the guys, because Genesis is still the best, most exciting band to come out of England in the 1980s. Lunch. I'm sitting in Duplex, the new Tony McManus restaurant in Tribeca, with Christopher Armstrong, who also works at P&P. We went to Exeter together, then he went to the University of Pennsylvania in Wharton before moving to Manhattan. We inexplicably could not get reservations at Subjects, so Armstrong suggested this place. Armstrong is wearing a four-button double-breasted chalk-striped spread-collar cotton shirt by Christian Dior, and a large paisley-patterned silk tie by Givenchy Gentleman. His leather agenda and leather envelope, both by Bottega Veneta, lie on the third chair at our table. A good one, up front by the window. I'm wearing a nail-head pattern worsted wool suit with overplaid from De Rigueur by Schoeneman, a cotton broadcloth shirt by Bill Blass, a Macclesfield silk tie by Savoy, and a cotton handkerchief by Ashier Brothers. A Muzak rendition of the score of Les Miserables plays lightly throughout the restaurant. Armstrong's girlfriend is Jody Stafford, who used to date Todd Hamlin, and this fact plus TV monitors hanging from the ceilings with closed-circuit video of chefs working in the kitchen fills me with nameless dread. Armstrong just got back from the islands and has a very deep, very even tan, but so do I. "So how are the Bahamas?" I ask after we order. "You just got back, right?" "Well, Taylor," Armstrong begins, staring at a point somewhere behind me and slightly above my head on the column that has been terracottaized, or perhaps on the exposed pipe that runs the length of the ceiling. "Travelers looking for that perfect vacation this summer may do well to look south, as far south as the Bahamas and the Caribbean islands. There are at least 5 smart reasons for visiting the Caribbean, including the weather and the festivals and events, the less crowded hotels and attractions, the price, and the unique cultures. While many vacationers leave the cities in search of cooler climates during the summer months, few have realized that the Caribbean has a year-round climate of 75 to 85 degrees and that the islands are constantly cooled by the trade winds. It is frequently hotter north, and on the Patty Winters show this morning, the topic was toddler murderers. In the studio audience were parents of children who'd been kidnapped, tortured, and murdered, while on stage, a panel of psychiatrists and pediatricians were trying to help them cope, somewhat futilely, I might add, and much to my delight, with their confusion and anger. But what really cracked me up was, via satellite, on a lone TV monitor, 3 convicted toddler murderers on death row who, due to fairly complicated legal loopholes, were now seeking parole and would probably get it. But something kept distracting me while I watched the huge Sony TV over a breakfast of sliced kiwi and Japanese apple pear, Evian water, oat bran muffins, soy milk, and cinnamon granola, ruining my enjoyment of the grieving mothers. And it wasn't until the show was almost over that I figured out what it was. The crack above my David Annika that I had asked the doorman to tell the superintendent to fix. On my way out this morning, I stopped at the front desk, about to complain to the doorman, when I was confronted with a new doorman, my age, but balding and homely and fat. 3 glazed jelly donuts and 2 steaming cups of extra dark, hot chocolate lay on the desk in front of him, beside a copy of The Post, open to the comics, and it struck me that I was infinitely better looking, more successful and richer than this poor bastard would ever be. And so with a passing rush of sympathy, I smiled and nodded a curt, though not impolite, good morning, without lodging a complaint. "Oh, really?" I find myself saying loudly, completely uninterested, to Armstrong. Like the United States, it celebrates the summer months with festivals and special events, including music concerts, art exhibits, street fairs, and sporting tournaments, and because of the vast number of people traveling elsewhere, the islands are less crowded, allowing for better service and no lines when waiting to use that sailboat or dine in that restaurant. I mean, I think most people go to sample the culture, the food, the history. On the way to Wall Street this morning, due to gridlock, I had to get out of the company car and was walking down Fifth Avenue to find a subway station when I passed what I thought was a Halloween parade, which was disorienting, since I was fairly sure this was May. When I stopped on the corner of 16th Street and made a closer inspection, it turned out to be something called a gay pride parade, which made my stomach turn. Homosexuals proudly marched down Fifth Avenue, pink triangles emblazoned on pastel-colored windbreakers, some even holding hands, most singing Somewhere, out of key, and in unison. I stood in front of Paul Smith and watched with a certain traumatized fascination, my mind reeling with the concept that a human being, a man, could feel pride over sodomizing another man. But when I began to receive fey catcalls from aging, over-muscled beach boys with walrus-like mustaches in between the lines, "There's a place for us, somewhere a place for us," I sprinted over to 6th Avenue, decided to be late for the office, and took a cab back to my apartment, where I put on a new suit by Cerruti 1881, gave myself a pedicure, and tortured to death a small dog I had bought earlier this week in a pet store on Lexington. Armstrong drones on. Water sports are, of course, the leading attraction, but golf courses and tennis courts are in excellent condition, and the pros at many of the resorts are made more available during the summer. Many of the courts are lit for night playing as well. Fuck yourself, Armstrong, I'm thinking, while staring out the window at the gridlock and pacing bums on Church Street. Appetizers arrive. Sun-dried tomato brioche for Armstrong, poblano chilies with an oniony orange-purple marmalade on the side for me. I hope Armstrong doesn't want to pay, because I need to show the dim-witted bastard that, in fact, I do own a Platinum American Express card. I feel very sad at this moment, for some reason, listening to Armstrong, and a lump forms in my throat, but I swallow and take a sip from my Corona. And the emotion passes, and during a pause while he's chewing, I ask, "The food? How's the food?" Almost involuntarily, thinking about anything but. Good question. As for dining out, the Caribbean has become more attractive as the island cuisine has mixed well with the European culture. Many of the restaurants are owned and managed by Americans, British, French, Italian, even Dutch expatriates. Mercifully, he pauses, taking a bite out of his brioche, which looks like a sponge drenched in blood. His brioche looks like a big, bloody sponge. And he washes it down with a sip from his Corona. My turn. How about sightseeing? I ask disinterestedly, concentrating on the blackened chilies, the yellowish marmalade circling the plate in an artful octagon, cilantro leaves circling the marmalade, chili seeds circling the cilantro leaves. Sightseeing is highlighted by the European culture, which established many of the islands as regional fortresses in the 1700s. Visitors can see the various spots where Columbus landed, and, as we near the 300th anniversary of his first sailing in 1590, there is a heightened awareness in the islands as to the history and culture that is an integral part of island life. Armstrong, you are an asshole. Uh-huh, I nod. Well, paisley ties, plaid suits, my aerobics class, returning videotapes, spices to pick up from Zabar's, beggars, white chocolate truffles. The sickening scent of Dracar Noir, which is what Christopher is wearing, floats over near my face, mingling with the scent of the marmalade and cilantro, the onions and the blackened chilies. Uh-huh, I say. Repeat. And for the active vacationer, there is mountain climbing, cave exploring, sailing, horseback riding, and whitewater river rafting. And for the gamblers, there are casinos on many of the islands. Fleetingly, I imagine pulling out my knife, slicing a wrist, one of mine, aiming the spurting vein at Armstrong's head, or better yet, his suit, wondering if he would still continue to talk. I consider getting up without excusing myself, taking a cab to another restaurant somewhere in Soho, maybe farther uptown, having a drink, using the restroom, maybe even making a phone call to Evelyn, coming back to Duplex, and every molecule that makes up my body tells me that Armstrong would still be talking about not only his vacation, but what seems like the world's vacation in the fucking Bahamas. Somewhere along the line, the waiter removes half-eaten appetizers, brings fresh Coronas, free-range chicken with raspberry vinegar and guacamole, calf's liver with shad roe and leeks, and though I'm not sure who ordered what, it doesn't really matter since both plates look exactly the same. I end up with the free-range chicken with extra tomatillo sauce, I think. Visitors to the Caribbean don't need a passport, just proof of U.S. citizenship. And even better, Taylor, is that language is no barrier. English is spoken everywhere, even on those islands where the local language is French or Spanish. Most of the islands are former British. My life is a living hell, I mention off the cuff, while casually moving leeks around on my plate, which, by the way, is a porcelain triangle. And there are many more people I, murder. I say this, emphasizing the last word, staring straight into Armstrong's face. Service has improved to the islands as both American Airlines and Eastern Airlines have created hubs in San Juan, where they have set up connecting flights to those islands they don't serve with direct flights. With additional service from BWIA, Pan Am, ALM, Air Jamaica, Bahamas Air, and Cayman Airways, most islands are easy to reach. There are additional connections within the islands from LIAT and BWIA, which provide a series of scheduled island-hopping flights. Someone who I think is Charles Fletcher walks over while Armstrong keeps talking, and he pats me on the shoulder and says, "Hey, Simpson," and "See you at Flutie's." And then, at the door, meets up with a very attractive woman. Big tits, blonde, tight dress, not his secretary, not his wife. And they leave Duplex together in a black limousine. Armstrong is still eating, cutting into the perfectly square slices of calf's liver, and he keeps talking while I become increasingly mournful. Vacationers who can't take a full week away will find the Caribbean an ideal spot for the alternative weekend escape. Eastern Airlines has created its Weekender Club, which includes many Caribbean destinations and enables members to visit many places at sharply reduced prices, which I know doesn't matter, but I still think people are going. Concert. Everyone is very uptight at the concert Carruthers drags us to in New Jersey this evening. An Irish band called U2, who were on the cover of Time last week. The tickets were originally for a group of Japanese clients who canceled their trip to New York at the last minute, making it virtually impossible for Carruthers, or so he says, to sell these front row seats. So it's Carruthers and Courtney, Paul Owen and Ashley Cromwell, and Evelyn and myself. Earlier, when I found out that Paul Owen was coming, I tried to call Cecilia Wagner, Marcus Halberstam's girlfriend, since Paul Owen seems fairly sure that I'm Marcus, and though she was flattered by my invitation, I always suspected I was one of her crushes. She had to attend a black tie party for the opening of the new British musical, Maggie. But she did mention something about lunch next week, and I told her I would give her a call on Thursday. I was supposed to have dinner with Evelyn tonight, but the thought of sitting alone with her during a 2-hour meal fills me with a nameless dread, and so I call and reluctantly explain the schedule changes. And she asks if Tim Price is coming, and when I tell her no, there is the briefest hesitation before she accepts. And then I cancel the reservation Jean made for us at H2O, the new Clive Powell restaurant in Chelsea, and leave the office early for a quick aerobics class before the concert. None of the girls are particularly excited about seeing the band, and all have confided in me separately that they don't want to be here. And in the limousine heading towards somewhere called the Meadowlands, Carruthers keeps trying to placate everyone by telling us that Donald Trump is a big U2 fan, and then, even more desperately, that John Gutfreund also buys their records. A bottle of Cristal is opened, then another. The TV is tuned to a press conference Reagan's giving, but there's a lot of static and no one pays attention, except for me. The Patty Winters show this morning was about shark attack victims. Paul Owen has called me Marcus 4 times, and Evelyn, much to my relief, Cecilia, 2. But Evelyn doesn't notice, since she's been glaring at Courtney the entire time we've been in the limousine. Anyway, no one has corrected Owen, and it's unlikely that anyone will. I even called her Cecilia a couple of times myself, when I was sure she wasn't listening, while she was staring hatefully at Courtney. Carruthers keeps telling me how nice I look and complimenting my suit.